Potters. Welcome to episode 242 of CosPod Podcast for all things cosplay. Happy Halloween month! Woo-hoo.
I can't believe I finger gunned that. I'm so sorry, people. Thumbs up, is that better? Sorry. I'm tired. It's been a long week. Hi, everybody.
Happy October. It is October 1st as we are recording this.
Spoopy month! Oh, yay. Yay! The best month ever. Spoopies.
Normally, I would call this candy month.
Spoopies.
Just because that's pretty much the very first thing that comes out in retail stores when it comes to Halloween stuff is all the candy.
All the candy, yeah.
But then I remember there are also the two other holidays called Valentine's Day and Easter, which are also full of candy.
It was a lot of candy. So much candy.
But at least Halloween month has usually chocolate candy.
Right.
Which is also very helpful. If only they would have more sugar-free. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge, wink, wink.
If they could have more dairy-free, that'd be even better. But, you know,
More candy for the people that want to eat it but have dietary needs.
Especially since as allergies are becoming more and more common, like, you'd think they'd be more willing to cater to people because of it. But, you know, whatever.
Speaking of allergies, that was the one thing that kind of impeded my ability to work on cosplay. I did work on cosplay, you guys. I actually did. I have something in show and tell. But I had to try really hard not to sneeze all over it constantly. Because now that the weather's actually fall-like in the state of Texas, it also brought ragweed with it.
Yeah, and it's been, from what I read in the reports, it's not only really hard, because even I'm feeling it, and I don't have those kind of allergies, but even I'm getting like a little nasally and drippy, and I'm just like, what the heck is this? But because of the not extreme heat that we didn't get this summer, it's predicted that the ragweed season's going to last a little bit longer until we get an actual really hard, cold, possibly even freezing temperatures to get rid of it. It's just like, oh man.
I am highly allergic to ragweed, and so I have been suffering a lot.
If what I felt is even a fraction of an allergy, I'm just like, dang, I can't imagine people living like that every single day. It felt crap.
Better living through medication is wonderful.
Yeah. Modern medicine, yay.
Yes. And I'm also really glad that, again, I did not opt to go to Texas Renaissance Festival this year.
Yeah.
Because you camp in the middle of a giant field where there is ragweed.
Ragweed. You would just be surrounded by all the tree pollen known to man.
You're allergic to.
Oh my God.
Yep. They have a ton of cedar down there too.
Oh, that sounds awful.
It just means that I have to be very, very diligent when I take my allergy medication when I'm down there.
That makes sense.
It's also why I usually choose to go closer to winter time when everything is dead.
When things are more likely to be dead.
Dead.
Yeah, the cold weather does help with that, but it's still a butt to deal with.
Though, with it being Halloween month, and TRF actually opens this coming weekend, I do miss being down there in full garb, costumed, as it were, and being out there and cosplaying with people, interacting with the players, as it were. I do slightly regret choosing not to go, but given the COVID situation, that regret usually only lasts about 5 seconds.
I understand completely.
Unless, of course, you happen to go down there as a plague doctor and can integrate a mask inside of your costume. I'm actually kind of interested to see how that goes this year, since the CDC has made an official recommendation regarding trick-or-treating.
Right.
And there's been a lot of question on how many people are going to try and integrate masks into their costumes, you know, Mortal Kombat style.
I've already seen an article posted on the Mary Sue about like 13 nerdy characters that you could be for Halloween that have masks incorporated. Like, there's one episode of Sailor Moon where Sailor Mars is sick, and she still wants to help the scouts out, so she's actually wearing, like, an appropriate mask as she goes out in her outfit kicking butt.
Nice.
Sailor Moon knew way back in the early 90s how important it was to wear a mask if you were sick.
Indeed, it helps with allergies too,
Yeah,
honestly.
it really
Less
does.
pollen. All right, well, shall we move into cosplay updates?
Yeah, sure. Who's starting first?
Either or, you pick.
Do we want to flip a coin? I don't have a coin near me.
Toss the coin.
I have no coin to toss to the Witcher.
You go first then.
Okay, I guess I will go first. I have a lot of things, but I'm probably going to go through them really quickly. But I have accomplished so much in the last 2 weeks that it's a little bonkers. Like, I made a full petticoat within the span of 4 days. Did I need to really do that? No. Did I want to do it? Yeah, because it's kind of fun and I enjoyed it. And after I've already made 4 petticoats, so I kind of already know what the flow is. I already had my math done because there's always math involved. And really, it's just cutting a bunch of really long rectangles and sewing it together. So it's fairly straightforward. It's just a time-consuming process made a million times easier by having a serger. Yay! So I will show this beast, quite literally a beast, as it consumes the entire frame for everybody to see. I even went pretty, because I always do, and there's this lovely little trim on the bottom that does glitter and does sparkle very nicely in the light that nobody will ever see because it's going to get covered by a dress. Which sounds about accurate, doesn't it? You put something nice underneath your costume and you hide it, because cosplay. Yay! So this is lovely and poofy. It's got 3 layers on it because I wanted it to be extra floofy. I'm actually tempted to make a fourth layer, but I'm debating on that because one, I don't want to make another layer. It's a lot of work. And I kind of like how it is right now, so I may just leave it be for my sanity because I already like it. So yeah, floof. So much floof. I think one day I may make like a little infographic on an easy way of how to create your tiers for your petticoat. Like, this is a tier, this is a tier, this is a tier. These are all tiers. Because that mathing part can be a little confusing for first timers if you haven't done it a couple times before. So just thought that might be kind of a fun thing to do. And of course, I always do mine as a full slip because I didn't want to have extra layers that I have to worry about. And I do that because this is crinoline. This is not tulle. I prefer crinoline because it has way more structure and body than tulle. Tulle really does get crunchy and flat over time. This don't,
Itchy too.
it's very itchy. This don't get flat, which is great. It is just a little bit itchy. Surprisingly, this tool, and I don't know what brand this is, I just happened to find it somewhere. It's got a slightly softer side than the other, so I tried to keep the soft side down. Even still, it's going to itch. So that's why I have a full slip on underneath, so that way I don't have to worry about it touching any part of my body, which is awesome. And I'm, unlike all the other people, I'm a pleb and I love to use elastic, so I have an elastic band. Usually, when you make a petticoat, you either do a button or a tie, so that way it can kind of conform to your waist. I find that with those, it slips so easily over time, especially as you walk around throughout the day, if you're eating, if you're sitting, if you're drinking.
Especially if you use a tie, depending on the material that you use for the tie, it can come
Yes, it
undone.
can come undone no matter how tight you make it, and it can just be uncomfortable. And I like the fact that if it's an elastic, it'll adjust to my size throughout the day or throughout the years as I continue to wear this. So it just makes sense to me to always go with elastic. I love elastic. It's the best thing. So there's item one, and it goes over there. The other thing I love about crinoline that you can't really do, I can't show this because then you'd see the mess that is my place right now. You can't do this with tulle, is that because of the structure that it is, if you just kind of plop it down, it still keeps its shape. So right now it's sitting on my floor in the nice little petticoat cone shape. It's so lovely. It's great. Okay, so the other piece is the actual costume itself. I got much more of it accomplished. Oh. It is off the dress form. And I can't really show all of it because it's so big. But what I
I
did.
love the fabric.
Isn't it great? So it's Silk Dupioni. And it's from the Silk Baron. Oh, it's so great. I love it. I specifically went
Not a
after.
sponsor of the show.
Not a sponsor of the show. I had to pay for all this and it was really expensive. It was like $18 a yard. And it's a full circle skirt, so it was a lot of yards. But I specifically went with this fabric because I love working with it. And I love the texture of it. It's got this nubby texture, which fits really well for the character that I'm creating this for. But what I wanted to show off was I did a bunch of appliqué at the bottom that is all these beautiful leaves. And it's really cool with the petticoat because when it sits, it creates these nice little creases in between the leaves. So it sits just right, and you get to see the whole pattern of the leaves at the bottom of the skirt. It's really cool. And of course,
I
we got.
note pockets too.
Yes, there are pockets on this. And there are pockets that are shaped like leaves. I've got two of them, one on each side. They're so awesome. Debating on if I want to add applique to them. I'm trying really hard to straddle the line and not over applique. It's really hard for me to do that right now because I'm like, you see how awesome this belt is and how much work I put into this stinking belt. I kind of want to put more. I have more of these and I want to put more on this. So trying to find some self-restraint, which is really difficult to do. And right now I'm in the process of doing some lovely beading on all of my spots. I just have these cool little bugle beads from another costume and a good turquoise color that I thought would be a good offset to outline all of the spots in. So that's the next task. And then I have some beads and some bedazzling with some rhinestones to add to this. It's going to get big, it's going to be glittery, and it's going to be lovely when this is all finished. I cannot wait to keep working on it.
Going to be dazzled.
It'll be very bedazzled. Yeah, if you want to see more of it, if you want to see it in its proper form, go check out my Instagram page because I have been posting process pics on that. And it looks so much better on the dress form than me kind of doing this on the screen right
Right.
now.
Because it's not shaped when you hold it up.
No, not at all. I think you will really appreciate the sleeves, Amber, because they're
I
listed as,
saw they're
yeah,
petaled.
they're nice and petaled.
Yeah.
I did a little bit of rounding on it, but the style is called
Right.
elf sleeve, so it's got a
Yes, because it's
good.
what Arwen's dress
Exactly.
does. Yeah, there are extensive instructions online for that, actually.
And but the sleeves ended up being just a smidge too long for what I wanted them to be. They actually started cutting
Right.
off at my hand
You have
here.
to shorten them a little
That's
bit, because otherwise they
exactly what
just
I
kind
did.
of end up being like Renaissance dress,
Yes.
scallop sleeves, which ends up being a little bit much when you're trying to like do stuff.
If you're trying to function with your hands and your arms in some way,
Right.
yeah. So I shortened it so it now comes to about my wrist, just a little bit of a flounce
Right.
to it, but it's got just enough of a swoop that it's just like, oh, look at this pretty fabric everywhere. It's really nice. I'm really happy with it. And that was from the pattern that I bought from sewist.com that I made myself. So it worked out lovingly. It's really great. Yeah, there you go.
And
There's an
again,
update.
speaking of the delays in shipping, if you purchase from those websites online, you don't have to worry about delays in shipping because you just print it yourself.
You just print it at home or at FedEx Kinko's or at UPS or wherever, and it's there and ready for you for less than $3. Yeah, buddy.
Or you can print it at home if you have the right printer. No, again, they're not a sponsor of the show, just it's a product that we happen to enjoy using.
That I reviewed last time, very lovingly.
Yes.
So that's what I've got so far. I'm sure I'll have more of it done next time that we record. I have zero clue what the wig is going to look like. I have the wig materials. I don't know yet. It'll get
I
there
have a
when it gets
fair
there.
idea, actually.
Oh, I would love to hear it then because I've been kind of stuck on what I want to do with the wig. I'm like, do I keep it simple or do I go bananas with it? Because I still have a whole lot of sparkle and I got a whole lot of applique that I'm more than happy to just go poof, all over it. Yeah, I could. I don't like doing. So Amber suggested if that I do it similar to my Rydia character, which is very big Texas size hair with
Doesn't
feathers.
have to be Texas size, but that's kind of the style I envision with the floof.
Yeah, I don't know. I try really hard to not use the same kind of hairstyles with each character. I try to change it up a little bit. So I'm thinking of keeping it really cute and short, but I'm thinking about accessorizing it in some way to work
Right.
with the character.
That's what I was getting at. Yeah.
Okay, because he's got some features to it that would
Right.
work. So I don't
Yeah.
know. We'll see.
I'm thinking like fascinator type thing.
Ah, okay, I could see that.
With feathers sticking out of it, like Renaissance style, because Renaissance hats, the fedora style hats or
Yeah.
the musketeer style hats do a lot of that.
Nice.
Just maybe in smaller form. I don't think you want a full musketeer hat.
I've done one of those before and it was awful. I ain't doing that again.
It's great if you need shade from the sun in Texas.
Is.
That's about it.
That's about
So
all
if
I
you're going to
got.
Scarborough Fair, it's great.
But yeah, that's what I have so far. So you'll see more next time, I am sure. Amber's gonna go off screen to go get her stuff. She has already warned me of this. And yes, Tamlin, elastic is life, elastic is love.
It's because it's not dry yet, and I don't want to smear it because there's puff paint all over it. But you remember that lanyard that I was working on last time? I don't
Oh,
know
of
if you can really
course.
see.
Yeah, we can see it.
I pulled a Val and I bedazzled it.
You bedazzled it with your elven filigree.
Yeah, I made my lanyard elfy, and then actually, these are the rhinestones from Rava back in the day.
Back in the day.
Because again, using up materials that I need to use up and not keep lying around forever
Yep.
because I'm not going to wear that costume again reasonably. So the rhinestones were exactly the right color as this
Nice.
lovely turquoise fabric that I got in the remnant bin at Joann's for the demo. And I actually really like how it turned out. Just the puffy paint is not dry yet, so I have to be really careful when I pick it up and put it down for right now so it doesn't smear everywhere and ruin all the hard work I did. But this is going to be my new convention lanyard, so I don't have to use those really cheap, like dollar corded ones. And then when I'm done, I can bedazzle the badge holder that you guys saw in the other tutorial and hang that on the end of the swivel hook I've got here in my hand. And then I can have a nice, pretty badge holder that I can use at every single convention and not ruin my badges, even those that have paper badges. So that's what I've worked on thus far. I still have a little bit of crap. I say that lovingly, crap on my craft table because one of my electronic headsets broke and I had to do some emergency surgery on it to fix it because I don't like waste and throwing things away. So that is currently sitting, the tools that I was using are sitting all over my craft table right now because I needed light. So yeah.
Yay! Well, cool stuff. I'm glad that you're still utilizing the components from your tutorial to make it into a functional lanyard for yourself. And of course, she was going to put elven filigree all over it. We knew that was what she was going to do.
Honestly, I wouldn't have done any patterning on it if I had been able to get the nerdy fabric that I wanted. But they were out, and I don't trust myself to print Triforces over and over again or embroider them consistently because that's what I would have chosen for my pattern. Like, even if I wasn't using puffy paint, even if I was literally stitching it down, I don't trust myself to be exact all the way down. So it's better just to get printed fabric, which nobody has in tiny prints. You can get large prints
Only the large
everywhere,
ones.
right? And it wouldn't have looked good because the width of this lanyard is just 1 inch. So embroidery it is. But it looks really nice, all things
Nice.
considered. And I think it will definitely be a statement piece when I wear casual clothes around conventions because it will be far more bedazzled than the rest of me.
Look at me and my shiny badge.
Well, the first place they're going to look is my neck because it's going to be very filigreed.
Very nice.
Assuming, of course, that I'm not wearing my Akon badge book, in which case they
Right.
might look at the book first.
Just be like, how many years have you been doing this, my lord?
I'm running out of space with the split rings.
Have to get another one.
I think I can fit like one or two more badges on it and then it's done. I'll
Well,
have to
hey.
retire that book,
Yeah.
write the sequel.
Well, since we're talking about conventions, we want to get to our topic today.
Let's do it.
All right, so today's topic, since conventions are starting to make their return, in-person stuff is happening, and even a bunch of online cons are still running their shindigs, I thought this would be a really good time to talk about cleaning your sewing machine. Because there's not a whole lot of tutorials out there on what you can do to clean your machine by yourself without having to spend a ton of money taking it in to get it looked at.
It
So.
is so expensive if you take your sewing machine in anywhere because they charge by the hour of labor. It's not by the service. It can get very expensive very quickly, especially if you have an older machine.
Yes, but there are a bunch of quick tips that anybody can follow that will work for the vast majority of consumer grade machines out there that'll make it easy for you to keep it in tip-top shape. So I hope you guys enjoy this. Welcome, Potters, to a tutorial we should have made years ago. I'm going to show you how to clean your sewing machine. Like any tool, if you take proper care of it, it will last longer. Regardless of your sewing machine, these tips will work for all consumer-grade models. I'm going to focus on cleaning out the bobbin case, thread guide, and thread take-up lever. Why should you clean your machine by yourself? Well, it's much cheaper than taking it in for service, and you won't be without your machine for days or weeks. And knowing how to clean can help resolve some of your issues with sewing. You should clean every 4 to 6 months, depending on how often you use your machine. If you sew 5 to 10 hours a month, clean your machine about every 4 to 6 months. If you sew a few hours a week, then clean about every 2 months. Here is a list of the tools that you'll need. Your sewing machine instruction manual, a bristle brush, which you would have received with your machine, microfiber cloth, small screwdriver, which may have also come with your machine, and sewing machine oil if your machine requires it. There is the optional spray air can, which I will get into momentarily. Before starting, make sure that you have unplugged and disconnected your machine from the power source for safety reasons. First, I'm going to unthread the machine. It's best to cut the thread above the take-up lever and pull it through as if you were sewing. This helps pull any fuzz from the thread out and away from the machine instead of back and in. Now I'm going to remove the needle, the foot, and open up the bobbin case. Your instruction manual will go over how to open up and unhook these parts of the machine. Read your manual and follow it. Every machine can be a little different. For the most part, you'll need to unscrew the needle and the sewing foot. Use a small screwdriver to get the bobbin panel open. I recommend that you don't take apart your whole machine at once while you're cleaning it, so you don't get confused on which screws go where. These machines are deceptively full of screws. Starting with one section at a time helps eliminate confusion. With the bobbin case open, remove the bobbin holder. Take your bristle brush and start digging in to swipe and wipe. The harsh bristles are meant to pick up thread and fabric fuzz that may have gotten into the crevices of the machine. You'll want to do several passes and clean out your brush often while you do this. If you have a side bobbin case, it's the same process. The only thing different is that opening this area might be more involved. Just check your manual for this. I also like to give a wipe to the needle holder and the back of the case plate. Basically, anywhere the thread may have gone through or touched, I will give it a good brush, because fuzz can end up everywhere. Most machines, you can get the small brush to fit the necessary areas for cleaning. Now, with the bobbin case, if you happen to see thread or fuzz stuck in a crevice that you just can't quite reach, you may want to consider using a small, low-power hand vacuum or a spray air can. However, be careful with this, because you could damage your machine by further pushing those particles into the mechanical components. I tend to stay away from spray cans because of this, and for the most part, the areas of the machine are fairly open that you can fit the bristle brush through it. When you're done brushing, you can do a little bit of oiling. Oil helps your machine run smooth, less catching of the thread, cleaner stitches, and the mechanical parts won't wear down as fast. Not all machines need oil. Those made within the last 5 years may not even require it, so check your manual at first, like I've been repeating. You also only want to use sewing machine oil, and you can get this at any craft store. Do not use WD-40. It's too harsh and will cause more buildup from your thread over time and damage your machine. Each machine is different for oiling, but you'll generally want to focus on the moving parts. I always do a drop right in the center of the bobbin case because that component is constantly in motion. And then a drop at the top where the needle clamp is, and a quick wipe down so it's not oozing all over. Then I turn the hand wheel a few times to oscillate the needle holder and ensure that the oil is going through the motions and it's going down the moving parts. So this area is finally clean and I'm putting it all back together. Next is the thread guide. This area is pretty simple. Wipe it down with your microfiber cloth and then quick brush with the bristles or with the small makeup brush. I like to run the bristle brush through the crevices in the same direction where the thread goes to kind of help guide out that excess fuzz. Now for the thread take-up lever. This will require you to open up the machine and really dig into the mechanical components. Much like the bobbin case, start brushing first. This will catch the majority of the thread and fabric fuzz. Focus on the take-up lever and slowly work your way down and out. Go the same path as the thread. Any fuzz that sticks to the corners, you can wipe away with the microfiber cloth. This is an area where I would not recommend using a spray can or vacuum because the bulk of the mechanical parts are here, and it's very tricky to get out the fuzzy pieces without taking apart the whole machine. So your focus should really just be on brushing and brushing alone. With my machine, I need to oil two areas around the take-up lever and the needle. Only one drop is needed. It's going to be different with each machine and you might not need to do this step, but because I haven't oiled my machine in a while, I'm going to go ahead and do this and give it a little boost. Manually turn the crank a few times once you're done brushing, wiping, and oiling. You'll be able to feel how smooth or clunky the machine will run by doing this. Feels rough as you turn, run through the cleaning process again before you close it all up. So your machine should be completely clean at this point. Rethread it and run a piece of test fabric, see how well it sews. Your machine should sound a lot smoother and the stitches look nice and flat.
And we're back.
Well, anything else that we need to cover?
No, ma'am. I believe that's everything we have for this episode.
All right. Well, let's roll with our outro.
All right. Well, of course, if you would like to join in the conversation or if you'd like to let us know what sort of Nick Cage decor you put on your sewing machines when you're at home, please feel free to join in the conversation via any of our social media, which, of course, you can find here.
If you're watching us live, all the information is located underneath Amber in the corner. For those of you who are listening, visit us at cospod.org, on Facebook or Instagram at Cosplay Podcast, or on YouTube and Twitter at CosPodcast.
You can also email us podcast@cospod.org, where you will get an answer from each one of us, probably having one or more Nick Cage memes at the bottom.
I've been doing that with the emails we've been answering over the last 2 weeks. We've had many Nick Cage memes go out. It's been great.
And they will probably get even worse because this is, of course, Halloween. Cue the music. And last but not least, of course, if you guys have not heard, if you are new to the show, our 10th anniversary, 10th, that's right, is coming up here in January. So, of course, if you guys have any special messages you would like to send us, audio, video, text, or otherwise, please make sure they are family-friendly, because we might play them on the show when we celebrate our 10th anniversary in January. So please start thinking about anything that you might wish to send us, and you guys can actually start emailing those to us if you would like. Again, that is podcast@cospod.org. Otherwise, we hope you guys are all staying happy and healthy out there. We hope that your preparations for Halloween are going swimmingly well. And we will wish you guys happy cosplaying. See you guys next time in episode 243. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, guys.